Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. After receiving a lot of requests, I am starting a new tutorial series covering how to use the STM32 as a I2C slave. The slave mode is harder to use compared to the master mode. Here the device is always looking for the data, and it should be able to handle the transmit and receive requests. The amount of data sent by the master is unknown, so the slave should be able to handle it too. It should also take care of different errors that could arise during communication. We will cover everything that I just mentioned. It is not possible to cover everything in one video, so I have decided to make a series for it. We will take small steps in each video, and by the time the series ends, we should have a slave device ready for communication. Let's start the Cube IDE and create a new project. I am using the STM32F103C8 controller. Give some name to the project and click Finish. The clock setup will be as usual. The system is clocked by the external 8 MHz crystal, and it is running at maximum 72 MHz. Let's configure the I2C now. I am using I2C1. The mode is kept to standard, and the I2C clock is at 100,000 Hz. Everything is kept to default for now. The address length is set to 7-bit address. The dual address allows the device to have two different addresses and communicate with two different masters. It is disabled for now. The address of the slave, let's set it to 12 hex. Remember that this is a 7-bit address. We will talk about the clock stretching and general call address in another video. Today we are just focusing on the initial setup. Go to the NVIC tab and enable the event and error interrupts. So this is it for the configuration. Let's generate the project now. Let's create a new source file for the I2C slave, where we will write all the functions needed for the device. Also create a header file, just in case required in the future videos. Now copy the I2C handle type from the main file. Include the main file and the I2C header file here. Now define the I2C handle as the external variable. I am defining the receive buffer size as 6 bytes, and creating a buffer to save the received data. Let's take a look at the functions available to I2C slave. Here we have the I2C enable listen function in the interrupt mode. It is used to enter the slave device in the listen mode, where it can check for any incoming requests by the master. We will call this inside the main function. Once the slave receives some request from the master, an interrupt will trigger, and the listen complete callback is called. Let's write this callback function in our I2C slave source file. Here we will simply put the device in the listen mode again, so that it can again look for the request from the master. We have another callback function here, the address callback. It is called when the address set by the master matches the slave address we set for the device. The parameters of this function are the I2C instance, the transfer direction, which basically determines if the master is requesting a read or a write, and the address match code. For now we will just focus on receiving data from the master. So first check if the transfer direction is the transmit direction. That would mean the master is transmitting the data to the slave and not requesting from it. If the master wants to transmit data, the slave will receive it and save it in the buffer. To receive the data, we will use the sequential functions. Here I am using the I2C sequential receive in the interrupt mode. The first parameter is the I2C instance, so we can just use this one. Then we have the buffer, the data size, and at last the transfer option. The transfer option I am using is I2C first and last frame. And if the transmit direction is such that the master is requesting the data from the slave, call the error handler. For the first few videos, we will just focus on receiving the data. Let's see the transfer option. It plays the most important role while using the device as the slave. You can check their description in the HOL I2C source file. Here are the different transfer options, and they are used with the sequential transmit and receive. For today's video, we are using the first and last frame. This basically means there is no sequential operation, and the function is just being used normally, as in a non-sequential mode. Here the last frame indicates that the slave will send a NAC response, after it has received 6 bytes. As long as the master sends 6 bytes or less, the slave will happily receive the data. But when the master sends more than 6 bytes at once, an error will trigger in the slave. We will talk more about the errors in upcoming videos. We have other frames here, and the important ones for the receiving purposes are the first frame, the next frame, and the last frame. We will see them in the upcoming videos tool. Since we are receiving the data in the interrupt mode, once the slave has finished receiving 6 bytes, an interrupt will trigger, and the slave receive complete callback will be called. Here we don't need to do anything special today, so let's just increment the count variable. If there is some error while receiving the data, the error callback will be called. We are not talking about errors in today's video, so let's just enable the listen mode again here. Alright, let's build the code. If you take a look at the initialization function, the device's own address, it's 36. We set the 7-bit address 12 hex, which was then converted to 8-bit address by shifting the address to the left by 1 bit. So that is it for the code, let's debug it now. I have added the RX data to the live expression, so that we can see the buffer during runtime. For the master, I am using the CJMCUFT232. You can simply use another MCU as the master, and send the data as shown in the picture. The device address is 12 hex, shifted to the left by 1 bit. And we will just call the HOL I2C master transmit function to transmit the data. Anyway, I am using a master device, and I have the Python script to send the data. This here is the slave address, which is 12 hex. I2C write simply transmits the data, and here I am transmitting 4 bytes. The slave has successfully received the data, and stored it in the buffer. Now I am transmitting 2 bytes. You can see it is also received by the slave. Here we have transmitted 6 bytes without an issue. Let's add the count variable to the live expression. It's set to 1 because I transmitted 6 bytes once. Whenever the slave receives the set number of bytes, the slave receive complete callback is called, and the count variable is incremented. This is a very important piece of information here. Since we have set the transfer option to be the first and last frame, when the slave receives 6 bytes, it will trigger the last frame option, and it will send a NAC response to the master, indicating that it does not want to receive more data. Subsequently, the receive complete callback is called. If the master sends less than 6 bytes, the last frame is never triggered, and slave never sends a NAC response. Also, the receive complete callback is never called. Let's see what happens when the master sends 7 bytes of data. Here you see the master didn't receive any NAC response from the slave. This is because the HOL library can handle 1 extra byte received, given that it is compensated in the next receive. Anyway, let's not go into this right now, as we will talk about errors later. Basically, if the master sends more than expected data, the slave will send a NAC response. So to keep the things working for now, is to program the master to send less data than what the slave is expecting. Of course, we will take care of this in the upcoming videos. And we will also discuss the errors which arise when the slave receives less data than expected. Everything will be covered, but one step at a time. So this is it for today's video. I hope you understood some basic things about writing the I2C slave code. We will continue this in the next video. The link to download the code is in the description below. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.